Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. The Lord be with you. Welcome everyone as we gather for our worship for this 20th Sunday after Pentecost. And we welcome visitors with us here this morning at Holy Trinity Cathedral and those who are joining us online. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. saving and healing God, you have promised that those who have died with Christ shall live with you. Grant us grace to be continually thankful for all you have done for us, and in that thankfulness to be eager to serve and live for others, so that we and all your children may rejoice in your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for these scripture readings.
A reading from the book of Exodus. When the people of Israel saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us, who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be the festival to the Lord." They rose early the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to rebel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf, and have worshipped it, and sacrificed to it, and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord, his God, and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It is with evil intent that he brought them up to kill them in the mountain and to consume them from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them that by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised, I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people." For the word of the Lord.
Thank you. reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honourable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
wisdom, grant that the words we have heard today may be grafted in our hearts, so that they may bear much fruit for your kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. The parables of Jesus are some of the most recognisable stories, not only in the Bible, but in the wider world of literature as well. We still refer to people who do a good deed for others as a good Samaritan. We refer to a young person who was reconciled to their family as a prodigal son or daughter, and someone who is having difficulties as being a lost sheep. There are 37 parables in the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Matthew tells 22 of Jesus' parables, 9 of which are found only in Matthew. At first glance, most of Jesus' parables are simple and memorable stories that convey a clear message or teaching. And yet many of them have far deeper meanings that can actually be rather disturbing. The parable before us in today's reading from Matthew is one such parable. Luke's version of this parable is about a great dinner, with no mention of any royal connections, whereas Matthew changes it to a wedding banquet given by a king for his son. In any society, even today, regular people aren't invited to royal weddings. Even nowadays, it's usually other royalty, high-profile politicians and business people, and most importantly, famous actors and pop musicians. Jesus says in the parable that among the invited guests to this royal wedding are a landowner and a business person, definitely members of the upper crust in that time and place. The attendance of the great people of a king's realm at the wedding banquet of the king's son would have been expected, not only as a demonstration of their loyalty to the king, but also to the king's heir. Excuses not to attend would be unacceptable and would be seen as a direct affront to the king. Another difference between Matthew's version and Luke's is that in Luke, the host invites everyone else to dinner after the first invitation is refused. Whereas in Matthew, the king sends out even more servants to invite the obstinate people of the kingdom to the banquet, which makes their second refusal even more shocking, as they once again show a complete lack of respect for the royal family. Some of the invited guests defy the king's honour in a more direct way, and seize, mistreat, and kill the king's servants. The king in the parable react as kings always did in that time and place to what would have amounted as a rebellion. But then the king does something that no king would have done. Having exacted vengeance on his enemies, he invites commoners to the wedding banquet. But why must other guests be invited when those who were invited first have refused? The reason given is that so the wedding hall will be full. The king needs to be honoured, and so he is honoured by those who can be found and who accept the invitation. It has been suggested that this aspect of the parable reflected a tension within Matthew's community about table fellowship. The rich and poor members of the community shared meals together. This was causing tensions because some richer people did not seemingly want to share their food with with those they considered not to be their social equals. A similar problem was noted by St. Paul in his letters to the Corinthians. The parable contrasts the elitist tendencies within the community with the generous welcome conveyed by the king. The point seems to be to the well-to-do in Matthew's community, if this king can be open and generous to others, why can't you? But then the parable takes an odd turn. When the king came in to see the guests, he noticed the man there who was not wearing a robe. And he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Many are called, but few are chosen." This turn of events seems at odds with the king's behaviour from just moments before. However, for such a special occasion, guests would have been expected to wear robes that were not their everyday work clothes, and also freshly laundered. Your clothes would not be expected to be perfect, but you would be expected to make an effort. The man in the parable has obviously turned up to the royal wedding in the ancient equivalent of a t-shirt and thongs. He just hasn't bothered to make any effort to be properly attired, and as such, his response is no different to those who refused to attend. It could be suggested that this itself would be particularly unfair, as the poor bloke has been pulled off the streets and then expected to dress properly at a moment's notice. But given that wedding celebrations lasted for 6 days at that time, the man would have had plenty of time to go home, get dressed, and come back. This part of the parable suggests that even if someone has accepted the invitation in the king's banquet, a person still needs to put on the proper garment. Not the proper physical garment, but the proper spiritual garment, putting on the Christian life, which in Matthew is about doing the will of God and bearing the proper fruit in your life. As such, this parable is not about smugly believing that we in the church are the good guys and everyone else outside are not. This is also not a story about the elitists, who do not accept the king's gracious invitation and get their due punishment, while those good Christian folk who say yes to the king end up warm and comfortable in the parish, in the palace, sorry, not the parish, enjoying the fruits they so richly deserve. The unsettling part of this parable is that it asks us whether we are open and gracious to others who we may not see as one of us, and whether we are willing to extend to them an invitation to the king's feast. And if we do accept the king's invitation ourselves, we are reminded today that we need to be willing to take off all that is not worthy to be a part of the king's feast, and to be willing to put on those things that enable us to bring honour to the one who calls us and has invited us all to his table. The Lord be with you. In our orders of service, we turn to page 7 and let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through whom all things were made, for us and for our salvation. Down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified and a conscious heart. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us pray for the world and for the Church.
Holy God, slow to anger and infinite in mercy, hear us when we bring our prayers for the world and the Church. We give thanks for this world, for the beauty we see all around us each day. We pray for the world for peace and cooperation between nations, for wise and honest government, especially in those nations struggling with war and civil conflict. We pray especially today for the conflict in Israel and Palestine, praying that this may not escalate into a wider war in the Middle East. We pray for those who have been killed and injured, those who have lost loved ones, and for wisdom and calm leadership on all sides. Holy God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for your Church, for all who exercise leadership, for those who minister in your name, and for all who worship you. We pray today within the Anglican Church of Australia for the Diocese of Melbourne, for Archbishop Philip Prayer, Regional Bishop Paul Barker, Genevieve Blackwell, Brad Billings and Kate Proud, and for the clergy and people of Melbourne Diocese. We pray for Dean Andreas Lowe and the clergy, staff and people of St Paul's Cathedral in Melbourne. Within our own diocese, we pray for our Bishop Clarence, and today for the parish of Brother Glen Children, for the priest in charge, Scott Jessup, for Ruby, Maggie and Claire, and for all the parish leaders and congregations of St Stephen's Brother Glen, St Paul's Children, All Souls Barnawaza, and Christ the King, Wagunya. Holy God, in your mercy, we give thanks for our local community, for all who support and encourage us in our daily life. We pray for all who live in our community, for our families, our friends, and all with whom our lives abound. We pray within our community for Anglicare Victoria, for CEO Paul McDonald, and for Anglicare, you, for the Reverend David Still, for all staff, volunteers, and clients, and for the ministry of Loaves and Fishes, Christians Caring. Holy God, in your mercy,
amen.
We give you thanks, O God, that or the lonely and isolated, for those who are lonely or anxious, and for all who grieve, for those on our parish list of prayer, and for all those who are sick, in pain, or close to death. Be present with them in their pain, that they may know the comfort of your peace. Holy God, in your mercy. We give you thanks, Holy God, for your faithful people of every generation, for all who have walked in your way and now find their eternal rest in you. We remember those who have died, for Bruce McDonald, and for those whose years mind the curse of this time. Clothe us in your truth and compassion, that when you call us to your wedding feast, we may be found ready with all your saints to enter into the joy of your eternal presence. Holy God, in your mercy.
Holy God, we bring before you our own prayers. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
incense, my prayer rises to meet you. My arms stretch out, lifting you high. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works.
My incense, my prayer rises to meet you.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. And I will sing praise to my God while I am here. My incense, my prayer rises in me, my arms stretch out, lifting me high. Sanctify this bread and wine, that we can share in this holy sacrament, making partakers of Christ's body and blood. Who, when his hour had come, on the night before he went up to the cross, to make full atonement for the sins of the whole world, offering once for all his one sacrifice of himself, took bread and gave him thanks. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Amen.
commemorate and celebrate his saving passion and death, his mighty resurrection and ascension into heaven. And we eagerly await his coming again in glory. We thank you that by your grace alone you have accepted us in Christ, and here we offer you a spiritual sacrifice, holy and acceptable in your sight. Through Christ, receive this our duty and service, and grant that we eat and drink these holy meals, made by your Holy Spirit, be one body in Christ, and serve you in unity at peace. In your grace and mercy, bring us to the joy of your eternal kingdom, with all the company of the redeemed. May we praise you in union with them, and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we bless you, Father eternal, in songs of never-ending praise. Let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ, in remembrance that he died for us. Feed on him in our hearts, by faith, with thanksgiving. Thank you. Once again, welcome to visitors we have with us this morning. We hope you can join us for morning tea, which is in Pembroke Hall, which is out to the right as you leave the cathedral. Just a reminder that we have our first of our Seniors Week concerts this afternoon at 2 p.m. An afternoon of music with the Rangaratta Concert Band. Entry is by gold coin donation. And unfortunately, the other Seniors Week concert was left out of the bulletin, and that's on Tuesday, and that's the Sounds Organic Concert with Kieran. And what time is that one? 11:30 a.m. on Tuesday, 17th of October, 11:30 a.m. So please remember and support that concert as well. We were saddened to hear during the week of the passing of Bruce McDonald, Rob's brother, and his funeral will be held on Thursday at 2 p.m. at the cathedral. If you're at the family would like afternoon tea in Pembroke Hall afterwards, the catering is being looked after, but if you can help with either set up, serving, or clean up on Thursday afternoon, could you please see me after worship this morning? It would be good to have a little team together just to be able to serve afternoon tea after the funeral. Then next Sunday is Choral Evensong at 5 p.m. Please note the new time, the warmer months. It's now back to 5 p.m. So 5 p.m. next Sunday. And if you're able to help with supper after the Evensong, please see either myself or Stephanie. Then on Saturday the 28th, we have the Diocesan Eucharist celebrating the season of creation. You can RSVP to that either by going on to the QR code on the poster, which is hanging in the doorway there, in the porch of the cathedral, or if you'd like to see me, you can let me know you're attending and I'll let the registry know that you're attending. We also have new giving envelopes. They're available and they can be used from the first Sunday of November. So whether you have been using envelopes for years or would like to use them, please feel free to take a box from the table near the entrance. We don't keep records of who gets what number or how much is given, so please feel free to take those boxes envelopes if you would like them. This year we'll be holding our All Souls commemoration on Wednesday the 1st of November. That's because we have our All Saints celebration on Sunday with the Jazz Mass. So we'll be having our All Souls commemoration on the 1st, which is actually the Feast of All Saints, but as it's a Wednesday and we'll be celebrating All Saints on Sunday, our All Souls commemoration will be on Wednesday. And if you wish to hold someone in remembrance on that day, there's a list on the table near the front door. As there is a list for Christmas puddings, if you'd like to order a Christmas pudding or several, you can put your name on that list. And as I say every year, please don't get the All Souls list and Christmas pudding list mixed up. Thank you to the Savory family who are donating more funds raised to the cathedral for that. I think that's all. Would you please stand for the sending here?